just burning in my heart. I actually have like 5 of them. But I was going to preach this morning because I felt and I've seen, who here like just believes in God? If you don't, that's okay. You will. But if you believe in God and you believe the word of God, then you also must acknowledge that Satan is real. And it doesn't take half a brain really to realize that there's forces of darkness on this planet, and they are trying to stop you from fulfilling your destiny and your calling. They can't stop you if you don't let them, but they will try. And so I have a message that I have shared a number of times called Satan's 7 Strategies. And I really want to share that with you because I believe it's going to help you to overcome. Pardon me, Andrea? Yeah, I'm going to. I'm going to preach the hell out of you next week. Because we're all battling. Who here, just life is a battle sometimes. And just even to maintain your peace and to maintain your joy, you have to make a quality decision. And things that are good that happen, and if you want to be a successful person in all the right ways, it will happen intentionally. Very few amazing things in the long run happen by accident. And so we have to learn how to live intentionally and how to fight the good fight of faith, as the Bible says. And then I'm going to start a 3-week series called Line in the Sand. Because this church was foundation. The reason we started this church is because the Holy Spirit spoke to me and we recognized that there is a legitimate need in our region for the power of God. And not just ho-hum religion or church services, but authentic power. So when you read the New Testament, when you read the Bible, it's full of miracles. It's full of people getting healed. It's full of just amazing power. You look at the life of Jesus. He went around, the Bible says, doing good, healing every person who was oppressed of the devil. He was raising the dead. He interrupted funerals. I mean, Jesus had power.
He washed and kissed the feet of people that had leprosy.
He didn't do that.
Didn't he?
But people did that to him. Prostitutes came in and washed his feet with their tears, and he restored the lives. I mean, he did it all. He healed broken hearts. And I believe that is what we're supposed to be like as believers. We are meant to, the Bible says in Mark chapter 16, these signs will follow those who believe. So the signs don't follow super apostle, prophet, magnificent people who fast every day, mark and read their Bibles, and they just live these lives of asceticism and they never eat meat. No, meat's good. These signs follow normal everyday believers who decide that they're going to step out in faith and release the anointing and the power that God has put inside of them. Amen?
Yeah.
These signs will follow those who believe. They will lay hands on the sick and they will recover. They will speak in new tongues. If they drink anything deadly, it will by no means harm them. Oh, sorry, I got it wrong. And they will lay hands on the sick and they will recover. Amen? This is meant to be. And so there's a lot of people in our city that claim, well, I don't believe in God. Well, once you pray for their back, if they're like, well, you don't believe in God, do you have this? I ask people this all the time. Do you have any pain in your body at all? 50% of the time they say, well, yeah, my wrist has been bothering me. Well, you're going to believe in God in a moment after I pray for your wrist. May I pray for your wrist? And 99% of the time they say, yeah, sure. Right? Show me the money. And so you pray for their wrist. And guess what? People could say, well, what if it doesn't happen? Well, what if it does? What if it does? I've prayed for many people and they didn't get healed, but I prayed for many and they do instantaneously.
Yes.
So you pray for their, and I don't pray to God for healing, because that's not biblical. Jesus never did that. He just released the power of God and declared healing. So I say, in the name of Jesus, I release the power of the Holy Spirit over your wrist, and I command you to be healed in Jesus' name. I release God's Spirit right now. Holy Spirit, come, let your kingdom come and heal this wrist. In the name of Jesus, and then I just wait as long as they'll let me hold their wrist. Because I'm telling you, the anointing of the Holy Spirit is substantial. Amen. You know people that they get prayed and they fall under the power or whatever? That's not gimmicks. Sometimes it's fleshly stuff, people wanting attention, whatever. But many times it's the power of the Holy Spirit coming upon someone to the point that he overwhelms them and they just can't stand anymore. Amen. So I just pray, as long as it gets really, sometimes it gets awkward and they're like, you're not letting go of my hand. I'm like, I know. Yeah, because God's not a microwave. You can't just zap your coffee. You know, you gotta, you know, warm it up on the stove. So I'm just like, it's better that way anyway. I'm just letting, and so what happens is they go, holy, my wrist is better. And I say, that's Jesus. Boom, it's a line in the sand. And then people have an authentic experience with the gospel that is more than words only. If they don't have any pain, I say, let me prophesy over you. I want to tell you something that when I tell you, God hasn't given me anything yet. And then I say, okay, God, show up. And occasionally I don't sense anything and I'm just like, okay, this is awkward. I'm just going to pray for a blessing. But most of the time, God gives me something. One time I was evangelizing to some youth and I used that. You know, I had prayed for them and whatever, and nobody had pain. So I said, let me prophesy over you. And the guy goes, me first. So he came up to me and I take his hand and God said, he grew up without a dad. And I said, okay, how do I frame this in a loving way? I said, God is telling me that he wants to be your father because you grew up without a father. And he goes, how did you know that? It's God. Boom. Line in the sand. Paul said, when I came to you in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, I didn't come to you trying to convince you of the gospel. I didn't come to you trying to persuade you with wisdom, with words of wisdom. I came with fear and trembling, but I came with a demonstration of the Holy Spirit and power, so that your faith would not be in the wisdom of man, but in the power of God. We need people with more, with their faith that is in the power of God. Because it's the power of God that's going to change people. That's why we named our church Dunamis Church. Dunamis is the Greek word for power. And you know what it means? It means power. Power of God to do miracles, signs, and wonders. Power of God to raise up the body of Christ. That you're not living a life of defeat, but you're living a victorious life in Christ Jesus. Amen? Amen. You're full of joy. You're full of peace. You're successful. This is what God has for you. He doesn't have defeat for you. He has success for you. So, last Friday night, Carly wanted to go to a meeting at the Gathering Place Church where there was a young girl from Iceland. And I said, okay, let's go. I wanted to go too. So we went. And I met Elin, who's our guest speaker this morning. And she just had the fire of God in her eyes. And she's a pretty new Christian. She gave her life to God 2 years ago?
No, 8 years ago.
But really gave your life.
Really dip my toe in the water.
Dip? Two and a half years ago.
Not dip my toe, I threw my toe.
Okay, so she dipped her toe in the water 8 years ago. But 2.5 years ago, she threw her whole self into the water of the kingdom of God and gave her life to the kingdom. And so I asked her this morning, I said, why don't you come over and why don't you preach? Because she shared her testimony and, you know, I said, you're a preacher. Why don't you take the word and just give it, preach the hell out of us on Sunday morning. And so she said, okay. And so that's why she's here. So Elin Mogensen, did I get that right?
Yeah.
You kind of got to get a little nasal congestion going on that you can get the last name. Everyone say Elin. And then go Mogensen.
Yeah.
That's good.
Okay. So she's gonna share the word that God's put on her heart and she can have, you can have your way. Let me pray for you. Baby, why don't you come up here for a minute? Put out your hands here for a minute. Father, I just thank you for Elin. I thank you for her life. 24 years old, from Iceland, on fire for Jesus. Lord, you're reaching people in every nation, and we just thank you for Iceland as a nation. We thank you for Elin. Just pour out your presence and your peace and your power on her today, and help her just to share from her heart. We just welcome the word, I believe, that you have for us through Elin this morning, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Do you want to know my middle name?
Magnea. Anyone? Any takers? No? Magnea. Close enough of it.
Who names their kid Magnea?
Wow.
I am very happy to be here this morning. Thank you, John and Carly, for inviting me to come and preach the hell out of you. Aren't you just so thankful for Jesus?
Yes.
He is, oh my goodness. I could just bathe in it. I could just literally just lie down. And I often do, just lay down and just bathe in His goodness and His glory, because His desire is always to bless us beyond everything we can ever imagine.
Yeah.
His desire is always what's best for us. Mm-hmm. His desire is always to have His love upon you. Aren't you just so thankful for Jesus?
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Can we just take a moment and just pray that out? Just, Daddy, I am so thankful for Your goodness, and I'm not gonna ask You for anything at this moment. I'm just gonna say thank You. I'm just gonna say thank You for everything that You have done, everything that You are doing, and everything You're yet to do. Because thankfulness is a mighty weapon. Thankfulness releases stuff. It releases a lot of stuff. Thankfulness releases more of His goodness and more of His glory. Because if Carly gave me a gift and I was like, cool, that's neat. She wouldn't really want to give me another gift, now would she? But if I'm like, Carly, thank you, I honor You for that. He goes, oh yeah, well, I got more of that. There's more where that came from. Ephesians chapter 1. Do you have your Bible with you? Anyone? Yeah, good for you guys. It's very important to bring your Bible to church. And I'm not just saying it because Josh told me to, no, he did not ask me to tell you that. But I'm telling you it because it's my opinion. Because, you know, the power of God and the Word of God, the Word of God is the power of God.
Yeah.
And if you don't know the stuff in here, let's say if a snake bit you, you need your antidote, eh? Mm-hmm. And if the enemy shows up and you don't know your antidote, what are you going to do? Anyway, let's turn to Ephesians chapter 1, would you please? Ephesians chapter 1. Verses 3 through 14 speak about that He has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. That He lavished upon us before the foundation of the world, before you were even born, before you were even conceived, He lavished upon you every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. And what does that mean? That means that everything that you need, everything that you might ever need, anything that you have ever needed is there.
Yeah.
He thought of everything, and He did not only seal it with the promise of the Holy Spirit, He guaranteed it with an oath that He will never leave you, that He will never forsake you, that He will always take care of you, that He will never, ever, ever forsake you.
Yeah.
So how do we receive that? How do we position ourselves to go, okay, God, what are we doing? What do I need to do for that to rest upon me? What do I need to do for the glory of God, for the blessing of God, for every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places to rest upon me? What do I have to do? How do I position myself for that? And it's easy. You say, yes, God. Heaven is not complicated. Heaven is far beyond complicated. Heaven is His love in its purest form. You look at that child, I look at Divina, and I just want to love on her, and she's not even mine, and I don't even know her for that matter, but I just want to love on her, and that's God's heart for you as well, because He's so cute, she is adorable, I heard that. Seeing adorable. And you are adorable in God's eyes. Isn't that crazy? Even on your worst day, God is like, oh my goodness, I just love you. With your makeup running and your raccoon eyes and everything, he's just like, oh my goodness, you're mine, I love you. Anyway, going back to the point, how do I position myself to receive God's blessing? And it's not about, oh, I have to do this stuff in order for God's blessing to rest upon me. No, it's about positioning yourself. You do not, you cannot, even if you try to, you cannot add anything to God's grace. Yeah. It's a gift, it's not something of your doing. And if you're trying to work your way into it, you are positioning yourself into the law. But if you're in the law, you cannot be in the grace. So which one are you going to be? Are you going to work your way to it? Because in the world, you hear stuff like, oh, if you gotta work your way up the ladder. If you want to be CEO, you gotta do your job. You gotta be here for 11 hours a day. You can't eat and you can't sleep and you gotta do everything that you can in your own power to do this stuff. Yeah. But God is like, just rest, baby.
Yeah.
Just come, just drink of my water and rest.
Yeah.
Mark 6:31 was the verse that I received before. I've been away from Iceland for about 5 weeks, 6 weeks, I'm not even sure. And God told me to come and just rest in me. Because it's not about what you can do, it's about what He has done. And He is not going there, oh my goodness, I should not have blessed you with that one. Kind of regretting that one. Because you are. You did not show up for church on Sunday. Should not have given you that blessing. No, that's not what he's saying. He's like, oh, let me give you more of that. And let me teach you. Let me mature you. Let me grow you so you can understand what I'm doing. Let me show you what I'm doing so you can mature. So you can step into your fulfillment.
Amen.
When a baby is born, they first receive their mother's milk. And then when they grow older, they start having sweet potatoes and carrots and stuff.
Bananas.
I mean, you know, their mother is massing it up and making this little pudding for them. And then when they grow a little bit older, they can bite into the carrot. And then maybe they can even have some steak. They grow, they mature. And God, He disciplines us. Along with giving us every spiritual blessing, He disciplines us. Just as Carly and Jones, they discipline Davina because they know what's best for her. They know because they've been in that path. They see her from a different perspective than sees herself.
Wow.
God sees you from a different perspective as you do. So His desire for you is always what's best for you. He has blessed us with every spiritual blessing. Just say that for a minute. Just, Daddy, I thank you for blessing me with every spiritual blessing. Just release that upon yourself. Daddy, I thank you for blessing me with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. But then He disciplines us. It's a journey. Oh my goodness, it's a journey. It's a fun journey. Don't be intimidated when God is disciplining you. He's doing it because He loves you. You wouldn't give a Lamborghini to a 3-year-old, no, would you?
No.
The baby has to grow into it. The baby has to mature. The baby has to develop. And just as with us, we have to develop, we have to grow, we have to mature. And when that happens, then stuff starts happening. Then, oh my goodness, then you're in for a ride. Then the roller coaster ride happens. Because when God blesses you, the Hebrew word for a blessing means that he gives you something that it's not humanly possible to do. It's something way, way, way out of our hands. We cannot make that stuff happen on our own. So when we position ourselves, when we say, okay, Daddy, I am ready. I don't know what you're doing, but I'm willing to make it happen. I'm willing to participate in what you're doing. I'm willing to let you discipline me. I'm willing to allow you to do work in me because because I want that blessing. I want what Ephesians 1 says. I want what the Bible is talking about. I want that. I want to see it manifest in my life. I want that. How bad do you want it? How bad do you want Ephesians 1 in your life? How bad do you want, a little bit of it is that he lavished upon us every spiritual blessing. Lavished. He was not, he's a little bit of it. He's like, no, here's everything of it. How bad do you want it? How bad? How much are you willing to sacrifice and give up in order for God's glory and God's blessings to rest upon you? Can you give up your sin? Can you give up that thing in your life that's keeping you away from God? Can you give up the shame and the guilt and the hurt and the pain of the past in order for God's blessing to rest upon you? Are you willing to say, I am not content where I am, I want more? Are you willing to say, I will not conform to the patterns of the world because I want more? Because I want to show God's glory. I want Ephesians 1 to rest upon me. How far are you willing to go? Can you step out of the water? Can you step out of the boat? Can you step into the shore? How far are you willing to go? Because if you step out of the boat and onto the water, I promise you, God is there. He is there. He's always been there. He's just waiting for you. God, he does the work, but he needs your yes. He needs your yes, because he's a gentleman, and he will never force himself on you. He's never going to be like, oh, you don't want that? Oh, I'm still going to give it to you. He wants your yes. He needs your yes. Heaven needs to be in agreement with earth. He wants your yes. He needs your yes. Allah, oh my goodness, I waited for years to God to miraculously show up. And I'm not saying God is a God of miracles, and God is a God of spontaneous. But most of the time, he wants your yes in order for you to participate in what he's doing, because then you're in part, you are involved in it, you are part of it. You have invested something of your own in it, and he wants that for you. He wants you to be a part of the process. And for years, I was just waiting for God to miraculously show up and change my entire life, and I was not willing to be any part of it. I just wanted it to happen. And let me tell you something, nothing happened for years. I was stagnant, I was stuck, I was miserable for years because I didn't move, because I was too afraid to move. I was too scared that I might fail, that I might flunk. I hate the word mistake. I hate it. I absolutely loathe it, because in my mind there's no such thing as a mistake. Just a second chance, just a second opportunity. So if I step out onto the water, and if I step out of the boat, and if I fall into the water, I can get back up. I can get back up because I want Ephesians 1 to rest upon me. I will not stop. Make that your prayer. I will not stop until it rests upon me. Until God's blessings, until his oath, until his guarantee, until his promise, until his sealed Holy Spirit is submerging every part of my being, I will not stop. What do you want? How far are you willing to go? You want to go to the nations? You want to preach? You want to go to Africa, minister to children? You want to be the CEO of a huge company and give money to the poor? What do you want? What's that dream in your heart that God put in there that never came to pass? Because I can promise you that he is the one behind that dream. He will make that happen. How far are you willing to go? How much can you sacrifice for God's glory to rest upon you? For Ephesians 1 to rest upon you. Because, some of you are not going to like this, but there is a sin in everybody's life. There's even a sin in my life. Sin keeps you away from God, not because God is bad and he can't take it. It's because the sin brings you shame and guilt. And sin and shame condemn you. They keep you away from God. I don't want to be hidden from God. Do you? Do you want to be hidden from God? Do you want shame to keep you away from him? The sin is the compromise, and the compromise ends the sin. Why are we compromising when it comes to God's glory? Why are we saying that this stuff is okay? Because this is just who I am. Why have we become stagnant? Why are we okay with being not okay? Why are we okay with not getting more of what God has for us?
Because it's where we're comfortable.
Exactly. It's where we're comfortable. Oh my goodness, the comfort space, the comfort zone. I hate it. Yeah. It brings you nothing. It just boxes you in. It just keeps you there. And the enemy is like, oh, you're happy there. Okay, I'm going to keep you there. Because he doesn't want the fullness of God to rest upon you. He does not want you to realize that Ephesians 1 holds literally everything you could ever need or imagine or dream of. He does not. He's terrified that you might realize what you have, what power lies within you. He is terrified.
Yeah.
And you know what the great thing about that is? You can make him shit his pants. I'm sorry, Josh. I promise I wouldn't say the S word. I did, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. No, but you can make him terrified. Is that a... I'm sorry. Make the enemy terrified of you. Because when you step into the fullness of what God has for you, you make him terrified. When you wake up in the morning, he goes, oh man, no, I don't want that happen. I don't want that happening. I don't want you to step into what God has for you. He wants to keep you there, and that's why he feeds you lies. Mm-hmm. You're not good enough. How many have you ever heard that? You're not good enough. You're not beautiful enough. You're not that enough. And you're not that enough. And God, you think God wants to bless you? It's a lie. I hate it. I absolutely loathe it. And we've been accepting that lie. We've been accepting the lie that, oh, here's just a good place to be. I'm just going to stay here in this little box and not step into what God has for me. God's like, baby, I just want to love you. I just want to bless you. Can't you see everything that I have for you? It's just right there waiting for you to accept it, waiting for your yes, waiting for you to maybe, I'm sorry, but maybe give up that sin, maybe give up that thing you've been holding on to that's keeping you away from him? Or a person, even, there might be a person in your life, there might be a sin in your life, there even might be...
The weight he's putting on you to hold you back from doing what you want to do.
Yeah. He's holding you back because he doesn't want you to understand the fullness of God, because if you understand the fullness of God, you become unstoppable.
Amen.
And it terrifies him. It terrifies, I'm going to say another S word, Satan. A lot of S words today that might offend somebody. I'm sorry about that.
Huh? You should just be an online preacher. I'd sit and watch you all day. This is great.
Oh, man. Jesus, thank you for your joy.
That's the next project.
Huh?
That's your next project.
Joy?
The online preaching.
Online preaching.
Should be.
Okay, if that is, well, go for it. If that's that, I'm in for it. Most of the time, speaking, I don't want to talk about myself, but to put it into a context, most of the time when God is in the move in my life, I don't know what he's doing. 99.9% of the time, I don't know what he's doing. I don't see the next step. I don't understand. But we don't have to understand.
Amen.
We don't have to. We don't need to. Because it's about a trust thing. It's about trusting that the Bible is not lying to you, that his intentions are always what's best for you. And when you know his heart, You're not afraid of it. You're not afraid of his intentions. When he moves from being just some guy in the clouds to being a god, to being a god with power, to being your father and to being your daddy, you start to trust him. And along the way, you start realizing how much he loves you. We can never fully grasp how much he loves you, but you can get a little bit of it. You can imagine, like, for even when you look at a baby, when even you look at a child, and you see how much you love that baby, and how much you just want to love that baby. And then when you blow it up into, you know, an even bigger proportion, you see, oh my goodness, that's how much you love me. That's how much he loves you. Do you know? I know that you know it here. This is a very, like, this is your nowhere. This is a very common base Malin's area. But do you know here that God loves you? That he is your dad. He is your daddy. And you can call upon him. You can run into his arms. Hebrews 4:16, approach his throne with boldness. When you understand that he's your dad, you're not, okay, I'm just gonna, hello? Terribly sorry to disturb you, but when you know that you are his child, you go, Daddy, I want that. Give me that. I want that blessing. I want it. I need it. I want to portray your glory and your greatness and your power and your might. And I'm so sorry for what I'm about to say, but God's glory rests upon holiness and purity. It does not rest upon sin and shame and guilt, because it keeps you away from him. And I say once more, it's not because God is keeping you away from him, because Satan is keeping you away from him. Because if you believe the lie that shame is yours and guilt is yours and condemnation is yours, you become stagnant. You get stuck. Don't believe that lie. You were born for greatness. You were born to be a child of the Most High King. A child. You're his daughter. You're his son. Step out into that. Start believing that. Start claiming that for your life. I want the promises of the Bible. I want to see the miraculous anointing of the apostles resting upon me. What do I have to do for that? What do I need to do? How do I position myself to understand that I am a child of the Most High King, designed for greatness, designed for inheritance, designed for miracles? What do I do for that? How do I get there? What do you think? What's the first thing that comes to your mind?
Like, just talk to God and have a relationship.
Exactly.
Eliminate the sin.
Exactly. Start talking to him. Start talking to him. Have a relationship with him. It's never about him controlling you. It's about him loving you and you having a relationship with him. We are issued by blood. Our relationship with God is never in doubt. Never, ever. We are sealed with the promise of the Holy Spirit. We are guaranteed with an oath. We are guaranteed with an inheritance. So why are you not talking to him? What's keeping you away from him? Is it sin? Is it a person?
Paranoia of, like, I live with my brother and they live below me, right? Like paranoia, like who gives a SH, you know what, about if, like, someone hears you praying, like, I don't care anymore. I'll do what I want to. And if people hear me praying, then who gives a damn? Hey, I think I'm some kind of kook or loud note or something. Oh, yeah. Good.
Oh my goodness, the fear of men, hey?
Yeah.
That's a great thing to be free from. Hey. Because it doesn't matter what people say. It does not matter. If I would have my way, I would be on the rooftop of every building that I come across and shout the name Jesus if I had my way. Because, you know, men, they... I'm sorry, guys, but they don't really have a say in what you are called to do. Because of what the world says about you is that, oh, you're not good enough, and maybe your father left you or your mother left you and you feel abandoned, and you know, everything in your life just works its way around that. But it doesn't matter. God's always been there. God is El Shaddai as well. He's the one who breastfeeds you. He's the one who nurses you. He's the one who hugs you, loves you. He's both of that. He's both the mighty one and the powerful one and the one that swings his sword for you and the one who holds you. What more could you ever want? Why are you not talking to that guy? Why are you not talking to God? And I'm not asking it, I'm not asking that question to point any fingers. I'm just trying to get you thinking of why you're not talking to him about specific things.
Fear of being vulnerable?
Fear of being vulnerable? Sure, I can relate to that. But vulnerability and honesty, those are powerful weapons as well. Thankfulness is a powerful weapon, and vulnerability as well.
Some people just go through like really tough, that's not me, but like some people just have to really get dealt a bad hand of cards and they have a really crappy, tough life and they just give up.
And what are you going to do with that? Are you going to be okay with being there, or are you going to advance from that?
I'm saying there are some people give up too quick, throw in the towel too quickly.
But God has already given you Ephesians 1. I keep going back to that. Ephesians 1. He has already blessed you with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. You have the power and the authority to step out of what's holding you back. You have the power to say, no, enough of is enough of that. I'm not going to be okay with being content. I want what God has for me. I want everything that he has for me.
Amen.
I'm trying to encourage you guys. Thank you. It's working good. Good. Oh man. I gotta keep saying, oh man, and Connie. He's like, oh, woman? Oh my goodness. I should go back to my notes, guys, shouldn't I? What do you think of that?
No. Just go with it. Ad
libbing is good.
Huh?
Ad libbing is good.
Oh.
You have to stay with her. Holy Spirit is speaking.
Oh, yeah, he is.
Run with that. Just run with that.
When there's a sin in your life, when there's shame and guilt holding you back, that's not the Holy Spirit pointing at it and going, oh yikes, how are you gonna get rid of that? He's pointing at it with love. Let me take that away from you. Let me bring something else in there. Galatians 5 talks about the fruit of the Spirit. Joy, peace, love, kindness, self-control. Mm-hmm. Every good and perfect gift is from the Father. So, when the Holy Spirit points at something in your life, it's because he wants something better for you. It's because he wants you to advance in where you are, what you have been doing, what you're about to do. He's pointing at it because he's saying there's a time for you to grow. There's a time for you to move on from what you have been doing and step out into the new. When the Holy Spirit is pointing at something in your life, he is shaking things up. He is bursting out a new song, and he's bursting out a new well and a new spring of water, a living water. So it's never ever, not ever is it a bad thing when God is pointing at something in your life and speaking to you about specific things. But you know why we're afraid of it? It's because we've been told that it's a bad thing, because the world conforms to another pattern, that the pattern of the kingdom. Did you get that?
No, say it again.
The world we live in conforms to a different pattern than the pattern of the kingdom.
Right.
Everybody get that? That's $1 million stuff right there. I mean, you are not called to be ordinary. You are not called to be just going through life, maybe every once in a while praying for Janice in the next booth in your office. No, you were called to go, hey Janice, I love you, God loves you. You were called to bring out the kingdom to wherever you go. But if there's something keeping you away from God, you can't do that now, can you? You gotta step out.
Yeah.
You gotta step out. You gotta go to the point where you know, I don't want that anymore, I want more. I want more. I'm tired of the enemy holding me back. I'm tired of the enemy robbing every good thing away from me. I'm stepping out, I'm stepping up. And when you go deeper with God into revelations of who he is, how much he loves you as a dad, you go higher as well. Do you know how the eagle, God in the Bible, is compared to the eagle? And in the natural, when the eagle comes upon a wind that's blowing in his direction and keeping him away from, you know what, going further, he uses that wind to rise above it. In the natural, isn't that crazy? How the nature God created portrays his glory? And how can we, just as the eagle, use the wind that's coming against us to rise above it?
Wow.
You say, yes, God.
Yeah.
You say, yes, God, I don't know what you're doing and I don't understand and I am terrified, but I'm willing to go with it because I know your heart and I know your intentions and I'm not afraid. I choose to not be afraid. I make a deliberate choice of today being a good day because I know you are good.
Come on. Amen.
I make a deliberate choice of being okay with not being okay because I know God is at work.
Yeah, I'm unashamed.
I make a choice every day to say no to the enemy and yes to God. Most of the time, as I just told you, I don't know what he's doing. But it's the greatest thing ever because it's an adventure, it's a journey. It's such an amazing journey. And when you advance in the kingdom, this happens. When you advance in the kingdom, you go one step further. And then all of a sudden, the world looks a little bit different. So what happens as well, when you start walking in God's kingdom, and walking in his glory, and walking in his greatness, you start seeing people around you. You start noticing Janice in your office that needs a little love. But you can't really, if you're here, and you're okay with being, not really advancing in anything God has for you, if you're okay with being just here, you can't really lift anyone higher. But if you start understanding what God has for you, if you start reading your Bible, bringing your Bible to church, get into that, dive headfirst into that, you start seeing people around you, you start noticing Janice in your office, and maybe even Jim as well, and you can lift them up. You can pull them up. You can say to them as well, and you cannot even speak in your words, but you can show in your life that there's a better way. Everybody say, there's a better way.
There's a better way.
You can lift them up and bring them into the kingdom.
Yeah.
And if there was another platform I could step onto, I would do that. Just to show you physically how you can do it.
Good word.
Woo.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Yeah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Yes.
Oh my goodness, aren't you just so thankful for Jesus?
Yeah.
Thankful for his discipline. Thankful for him pushing you.
Mm-hmm.
Kicking you a little bit. Come on. Come on. Keep going. I know that the world knocked you down. I know you were kicked. I know you were beaten. I know you've been fed a lie. But it doesn't matter because God is on your side.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter. Oh my goodness, have you read the Old Testament? All hell was breaking loose, and then my favorite part, but God. The Israelites, when they were stuck. They were literally stuck. There was an ocean in front of them, a little one, not even a spiritual one, but a little ocean. But God. Don't ever underestimate the power of God. Don't ever underestimate the power that lies within you, because when you say yes to the Holy Spirit, the power of his resurrection came upon you. The power that rose Jesus from the grave lives within you. Why are you hiding that?
Yeah.
Why are you hiding that? Is it because there's shame and guilt and condemnation that's keeping you away from it? And why is that? Gotta say yes to God. Gotta say yes to God. Every day, say yes to God.
Amen.
You need to break the box.
Mm-hmm.
Destroy it so you can't go back in.
Yeah.
I often compare people to a house in a sense of
it's only as strong as its foundation.
That as well, but that was not my point originally, but like when life happens, because life happens to everybody. Mm-hmm. I wish I could tell you that there's a way of avoiding that, but it's not. There's a way of overcoming it, but if you imagine a house and it's built on its great foundation and it has a roof and windows and flowers in the garden and stuff, and then life happens, and the flowers are torn up, and the door is broken, and there's a crack in the window, and cockroaches start coming in, and maybe even mice and stuff. And that's, you know, what happens to all of us. And there's kind of no way of avoiding that. But when you invite the Holy Spirit into your life, when you say yes to God, to allow him to do the work in you, he starts building a new window. Sweeping the floors, getting rid of the cockroaches. And then all of a sudden there's his mansion with his name on it.
Wow.
You can be that mansion. You can have rubies and diamonds and pearls and gold and silver all around you.
Wow.
It's written in the Bible. Do you doubt the Bible? I don't. No, everybody's shaking their head like, no, I don't. Sweep the floors. Ask God to build you a new window. Ask him to build a new door for you. Show his glory. Show his greatness. Shake it off. Start making a conscious choice of saying yes. When God asked me, somewhere in the mid of June, I left Iceland on June 18, somewhere a little over 2 weeks before that, I think. God told me to go on a 2-month journey of North America, and I had no plan. I had no idea what he was about to do. None. Whatsoever. But I say yes, and it's been the greatest thing ever.
Yeah.
All he needed was my little yes. But I could have said no and stayed at home in Iceland.
You wouldn't be here.
I would not be here. I would not have met everyone in here. I would not have missed Josh. I wouldn't have met any of you. And see what I gained from saying yes to God? Mm-hmm. My one little yes turned into this right here. And so many other encounters that I've had for the last 6 weeks. One little yes, because blessing, it gives away. Blessing is an ongoing thing. Blessing pours out. So if you say yes to God, I don't know what you're doing, but I trust your heart and I trust your intentions. Things start happening. What do you want? What do you want in your life? What do you want to see happen? Everybody's thinking of something. What do you want to see happen? How can you make that happen? Give it to God. Give it to God.
Don't give up
and give that to God. Two gives. Give up, give in.
No more excuses.
No more excuses. Yeah. Exactly, because excuses are a shame and a, you know, the condemnation thing.
More coughing up.
Yeah, exactly, because you were designed for greatness. You were designed for an inheritance of the entire kingdom of God. Do you realize how big that is? How huge that is? He has lavished upon you all wisdom and insight, making known to us in the mystery of his will. Oh my goodness, it's so good. Everybody say, he has lavished upon me.
He has lavished upon me.
Every spiritual blessing.
Every spiritual blessing.
Feels good, eh? Do you want to do one more time? Everybody say, he has lavished upon me every spiritual blessing. That's good.
Yeah.
That's so good.
Awesome. One more time.
He has lavished upon me every spiritual blessing. That is so good, because if you listen to it, if you repeat it, it starts manifesting. If you keep saying, oh, I'm not good enough, oh, I'm not beautiful enough, God's never going to bless me. It's so easy to look at it. I could go look at Josh and go, well, that's good for him. I am so happy that God blessed him. And, you know, Josh worked his way up to that point, and God, yeah, he just loves Josh more than me. Or I could go, God, I want what you gave Josh.
Come on.
Yeah.
Woo! Because I know I'm worthy. You are worthy. You are so worthy.
That's right.
You are so worthy. Do you realize it? You're not what the world has said about you. You are not. You are not. You are what God says about you, and your actions and what you do and what you don't do not determine your future, but God's word about you determines your future. Start listening to his voice. Dive headfirst into his word. This is good stuff in here. You can buy a Bible for like $40, but it's $1 million wisdom in here.
Yeah.
Kind of almost for free.
She loves her tennis.
How you guys doing?
Yeah.
Good?
Keep going.
You feeling tired?
No.
You feel refreshed?
Yeah.
You feel encouraged?
Yeah.
Do you want what God has for you?
Yeah.
Are you going to be content with the lies of the enemy?
No.
Are you going to step out into the water?
Yes.
I'm jumping in.
Jump in head first. It's the greatest thing ever. Because water has... This is the living water of God right there. And water in the natural has the power to either, it can be very calming, cool, calm, and collective, and just kind of embrace you, hug you. It can be very easygoing waves. And you know, some of you even might, you know, listen to the sound of the waves when you go to sleep. And it's just this soft thing. It's a very...
What about like a tsunami that can like light up?
I was actually just talking about the ocean and the waves of the ocean, but that, yeah, sure. But the power of water as well. In Iceland, I come from a place of fire and ice. We have glaciers and we have volcanoes in the same location. There's even a volcano inside of a glacier.
That's confusing.
That's sweet.
That's where I come from.
That's intense.
That's very intense. Yeah. And in the natural, if just for an example, in Iceland, we have a lot of mountains as well. And we have glaciers resting upon mountains. So throughout time, when the water, when the glacier melts, water starts rushing in. And you can, like, you don't have to go far away from the capital city to see, there's even a mountain that hovers above the capital city that has been broken down, and there's a pathway all around it where water has broken its course through. Do you see where I'm going with it? Mm-hmm. This is the water. This is the spiritual water. And it has the power, when you need it, to hug you and embrace you. Because God does that as well. He's not just swinging his sword, he's also hugging you. Wiping your tears. Yeah, exactly. And when you allow the water to rest in your life, it breaks down your mountain. It tears down your mountain. It tears away what is keeping you away from God. But you have to say yes. God is a gentleman. And it's so amazing. I wish I had a picture to show you or something, because it's glorious to see the way water moves its way around the world. It breaks down rocks. It breaks down a whole freaking mountain. And God is at work in your life as well with that. He can tear it every. He can tear everything away. And Hebrews 12 talks about his discipline. Do you want to turn to Hebrews 12 in your Bible? It talks about his discipline, and it talks about that you should not be afraid of his discipline. Because just as your Heavenly Father disciplines you, just as your earthly father, mother, father figure, mother figure, they put, not because... You say to a three-year-old, don't touch the stove, it's hot. And it's not because you don't want them to have fun, it's because they're gonna get themselves hurt. Mm-hmm. And God does the same thing. Don't be intimidated by his discipline. Allow him to do that. Because when you allow God to remove something from your life, he replaces it with a double portion. Mm-hmm. Every time. A double portion of what you need, what you hunger for, the goodness of his will, he replaces it with. All the time, he never fails. Put him to the test, I promise you, he will be there. Mm-hmm. And it's a lot of fun as well to do that. God, I'm putting you to the test! Show me your glory, show me your greatness! But you gotta say yes. Yes, God. Everybody say yes, God.
Yes, God.
Yes, God.
Can you do it a little louder?
Yes, yes, God.
There we go. Doesn't it feel good?
Yeah.
So good, because he is good. His intentions are always good. God's plan for you is hardly ever predictable and totally not what you imagined.
Yeah.
Sometimes not even safe, but he is good, and so is his intentions. Always good. Always, 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 always good. Don't be content anymore. Don't be content anymore. I'm pretty sure that everybody in here, you can think of something in your life that you want gone, that God wants gone. Mm-hmm. Something that's keeping you away from Him.
Yes.
Something that's holding you back. Give that to God. Just say, God, I don't want that anymore. I want what you have for me. I want what Ephesians 1 talks about. I want you to lavish your love upon me. Give it to Him. You're not doing it for me and you're not doing it for God. You're doing it for yourself. And God, He can take it away instantly, but most of the time He wants us involved. Because when you're involved in something, when you're involved in the process, you become committed to it. You look at it 2 years later and you go, I am so thankful that God chose to bring me onto this path because I'm invested in it. Because when I look back at it, I see my footsteps along with God's. And it's so hard to go back to what you let go if you see your own footsteps in it. You invest in it. You bring something of yourself to the table. Say yes to God. Yeah. Daddy, I want what you have for me. I want to see your heart. I want to see your heart. How many of you want to see God's heart? Yeah. Exactly. Dive in head first. Every morning I start with God. Show me my heart. Show me where I am. Show me what you want to do today. Show me your heart. What do you want to say to me? In what way do you want to talk to me today? Say yes. He knows you. He knows your heart. He knows you better than you do. Say yes to God. I'd like to pray for you to wrap it up as a congregation. So if I could have you stand on your feet. Shake it up a bit. You've been sitting for a long time. You are such good audience. Ooh. Thank you for coming today.
I'm okay.
Thank you for coming. Thank
oh, my you. Pleasure. Are you excited?
Yeah.
Are you excited about yeah. God's yeah. going to do in your life?
Come on.
Are you excited to shake it off what's keeping Him away from you?
Yeah.
Woo. Are you excited to shake up the sin and the shame and the guilt and the condemnation?
Yeah.
Let's go.
Yeah, come Let's on. Go. That's one of the fire for God right there. I love it.
I'm going to pray. I don't need to go to the gym. I got it right here.
Do you want to go to a rooftop with me?
Yeah.
I'm going to pray in Icelandic.
Come on.
Some of you have never heard that language. It's kind of cool. And it's going to sound like I'm speaking in tongues, but actually I'm just going to pray in my own language.
Is it intense?
It's very intense. Are you ready? Do you remember a volcano inside of a glacier? That's Icelandic right there. Himmelski Fari, þakka þér drottinn fyrir hvernig þú blessar okkur faðir með öllum himniskum drottinn blessunum. Fari, þakka fyrir sér hvert hjarta í rauninu, drottinn. Ég þakka þér, Fari, fyrir eldinn sem að þú hefur sett inn í hjörtun hjá fólki, drottinn. Ég þakka þér, Fari, fyrir hvernig þú ætlar að færa þig fram að drottinn. Hvernig þú ætlar að færa þig fram að drottinn inn í þitt ríki, drottinn. Fari, þakka fyrir draumana, drottinn, og ég kalla þess að drauma fram, Fari. Fari, ég kalla þess að drauma fram og ég segi við þeir, í dag áttu von. Í dag áttu von. Þetta er ekki búið fyrir að Guð segir þessi búið. Komdu fram, komdu fram. Holy Spirit, come and move without restraint. Come and do what you love to do. Come and move in our hearts, Lord. Daddy, we just say yes to you today. Whatever you want to do, or whatever it may look like, come and have your way. Help us, Daddy, to find the boldness and the courage within to step out into the water, to dive headfirst into the water. We're not gonna believe the lies of the enemy anymore, Daddy, but we're gonna believe the truth about what you say we are. We're stepping out, we're stepping out, we're stepping out. Daddy, raise up your army. Raise him up, God, raise him up. I call out the fire within you. That fire in your heart that's been hidden. I call it forth, come out. And I speak to your hearts. You have been doing such a good job of keeping you safe. But you can let go now because God is carrying you. You can let go now. It's a safe place. You can let go now. You can let go. Just come forth. Come out. Come out of hiding. Come out of hiding. Every one of you. Come out of hiding. There's a glacier inside of you that's waiting to melt. There's a fire within you waiting to spring forth. Yes to you today. Daddy, I say yes to you today. I'm sorry for not listening before, but I'm giving you my yes today. Thank you, Daddy, for your great grace and your mercy and your goodness and your kindness. I say yes to you today. I invite you to come and love me today. I just want to bathe in your love. Thank you, Daddy, for the joy. For the joy that rests upon each and every one of us around here today.
Holy Spirit speaking to me right now that there are some of us in this room and that you need the salvation of Jesus in your life. You need to give your life to Him in a fresh way, maybe in a new way, maybe for the first time. And if that's you, just admit that to yourself right now. That's me. That's me. And just pray with me right now. Just pray out loud. Let's say as a congregation, just to help the new people that just you need. You know you need salvation. Also over, are we live, doing this live on Mark?
Are we just finished?
You just finished? I felt like there was some people on Facebook world. Can we do it live just for a moment again? Is that possible? Does someone have the capability to do that? Maybe it's on video. Just say this with me, if that's you, just say this with me. Lord Jesus, today I give you my life. I thank you, Jesus, that you died on the cross for my sin, for my sin, for my shame. And today, I acknowledge, Jesus, that you are Lord. Be the Lord of my life. Be my King. Be my Savior. Be my everything. Holy Spirit, I surrender to your process in my life. Use me. Mold me. Shape me. Do whatever you want to do. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. And if you just said that for the first time or rededicated your life, just wave at me for a moment. If that was you, wave at me. Put your hand way up just for a moment and say, that was me. That was me. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Is there anything else you want to do? If you would like some prayer, Elin is going to be here for the next little bit. If you'd like some personal prayer, we can just line up over here or whatever. And she likes to take about 30 minutes with each person, but maybe we'll just leave a couple minutes each person. This is a message, before anyone leaves, Ricky, this is a message that you could listen to about 10 more times, I think, and still get something good out of it. So we're going to put this on Facebook. I encourage you to listen to it again, send it around to some friends and relatives, post it on Facebook yourself. Have an amazing day, guys. I love you. Get out to sell this week, and we'll see you next Sunday for Satan's 7 Strategies.